Read the goddamn poem.
Read it.
Okay. Once on a yellow piece of paper with green lines, he wrote a poem, and he called it Chops, because that was the name of his dog, and that's what it was all about. And his teacher gave him an A, and a gold star, and his mother hung it on the kitchen door and read it to his aunts. That was the year Father Tracy took all the kids to the zoo, and he let them sing on the bus, and his little sister was born, with tiny toenails and no hair. And his mother and father kissed a lot, and the girl around the corner sent him a Valentine signed with a row of X's. And he had to ask his father what the X's meant, and his father always tucked him in bed at night and was always there to do it. Once on a piece of white paper with blue lines, he wrote a poem, and he called it Autumn, because that was the name of the season, and that's what it was all about. And his teacher gave him an A and asked him to write more clearly. And his mother never hung it on the kitchen door because of its new paint. And the kids told him that Father Tracy smoked cigars and left butts on the pews, and sometimes they would burn holes. That was the year his sister got glasses with thick lenses and black frames. And the girl around the corner laughed when he asked her to go see Santa Claus. And the kids told him why. His mother and father kissed a lot. And his father never tucked him in bed at night. And his father got mad when he cried for him to do it. Once on a paper torn from his notebook, he wrote a poem. And he called it Innocence, a Question. Because that was the question about his girl. And that's what it was all about.
And his professor gave him an A.
And a strange, steady look. And his mother never hung it on the kitchen door because he never showed her. That was the year that Father Tracy died. And he forgot how the end of the Apostles' Creed went. And he caught his sister making out on the back porch. And his mother and father never kissed or even talked. And the girl around the corner wore too much makeup that made him cough when he kissed her. But he kissed her anyway, because that was the thing to do. And at 3 a.m., he tucked himself into bed, his father snoring soundly. That's why on the back of a brown paper bag, he tried another poem. And he called it Absolutely Nothing, because that's what it was really all about. And he gave himself an A, and a slash on each damned wrist. And he hung it on the bathroom door, because this time he didn't think he could reach the kitchen.
Hello, we are Group 4, and we will be presenting on narrative therapy. Our group members' names are David Eubank, Esther Portillo, Stephanie Martinez, Sandra Romo, and Atsiri Diaz. We will be looking at a character from the film called The Perks of Being a Wallflower. Our client's name is Charlie. An area of focus to work on with this client in order to circumvent potential relapse would be the area of counseling known as narrative therapy. The narrative therapy approach is being applied as a means to guide the client toward the reauthoring and acceptance of his story as a survivor and an individual worthy of compassion, care, and value. The following slides contain information about this approach, as well as the application regarding this client. This is Charlie. Our client is a Caucasian male teenager, 15 years old, from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Our client has brown hair, green eyes, and pale skin. Our client is from the upper middle class and seems to be in good physical health. Our client is a freshman in high school and has a particular interest in reading and writing. He enjoys writing and even receives extra assignments from his English teacher to work on during his extra time. Our client does not have a job, but volunteers at a local theater to help his friends. Our client's support system includes a supportive mother and father, an older brother that checks in on him when he's home from college, an older sister who alerts the authorities when the client has a breakdown, and Charlie also receives emotional support from his friends Sam and Patrick when they are in town from college.
Little secret, okay?
Look, Charlie, she's fast asleep.
Don't wake your sister.
My fault. It's all my fault.
It'll be our little secret, okay?
Stop it.
Candace, your brother's on the phone. Hello?
Hey, Candace.
Charlie?
Sam and Patrick left, and I just can't stop thinking about them so much.
What?
Candace, I killed Aunt Helen, didn't I? She died getting my birthday present, so I guess I killed her, right? I'm trying to stop thinking that, but I can't. She keeps driving away and dying.
Call the police and send them to my house.
Stop her. Crazy.
No, Charlie, listen to me. Mom and Dad are going to be home with Chris any second.
She's thinking. What if I wanted her to die, Candace?
What? Charlie?
Our client is presenting symptoms of clinical depression despite being on medication. Our client complains of worsening flashbacks, emotional distress due to life events, and feelings of loneliness and increased separation from others. The client also reports difficulty sleeping and frequent nightmares. While his symptoms do not appear to impact his productivity at school, even completing extra assignments from his English teacher in particular, it would appear that his symptoms are affecting his day-to-day life. Our client's presenting problem. According to the DSM-5, our client suffers from post-traumatic stress disorder, derealization, major depressive disorder, and recurrent episodes. The client experiences dreams associated to the traumatic event which he was sexually abused.
The client was diagnosed with clinical depression. While he frequently writes to express his thoughts, he is relatively confined within himself. The blackout experienced by the client appears to be a physiological way of handling memories of traumatic events.
I will be sharing with you the behavioral description of the client. The client, or Charlie, has expressed on various occasions through self-talks and especially with writing that he feels lonely and unnoticed by others. This causes him to become further withdrawn into himself. He expresses guilt over the death of his Aunt Helen, who he calls his favorite person in the world, but she's also the one who molested him. Her passing occurred during a trip to purchase a birthday present for him. This is causing Charlie to feel guilty. The client developed coping mechanisms to repress past traumas that are temporary in nature in the form of blackouts. The healing process is not being met with this suppressed routine.
Cognitive patterns and observations. First, we're going to look at the self. The client here presents with a very negative self-image of himself and a very low self-esteem. Throughout his story, we are able to find that he has negative thoughts about his physical appearance. He believes that he is not attractive. He believes that he is not as intelligent as other people around him. And he does not believe that he is as talented as his peers or his family members. Due to the trauma that he has, he often believes that he is not worthy of affection or love. He does not believe that he's a good person.
Affective manifestations. During the client intake, the client spoke in a very low tone of voice and was mildly withdrawn. He had difficulty maintaining eye contact when spoken to and would often fidget. When asked to rate his anxiety on a scale from 1 to 10, his reported number was 7. When asked about increased levels of depression on a scale from 1 to 10, he rated this an 8. Client interactions and causation. The client suffers from PTSD caused by the traumatic loss of a friend by suicide, accidental death of a family member, suppressed memories of sexual abuse by a family member during childhood, social anxiety, depression, and blackouts. The severity, however extreme, is being willfully concealed by the client out of fear of being rejected or labeled by peers, this causing detriment or worry to family and friends, also addressing potential reflecting signs of self-harm. Interaction with family. The client is agreeable with family members. He expresses genuine care and concern and enjoys when family comes together. He does not deal very well with change and suppresses emotions as not to raise concern on the part of his parents or siblings. While he may not agree with the situations that present themselves within his family life, he is not one to cause question or raise concern with individuals to make them feel any less for their mistakes, their thoughts, or their emotions. Interaction with peers. The client appears to be drawn to the authority type figures. He does not typically interact with students his own age. Rather, he gravitates to older students, which may indicate the sought-after guidance and repressed grieving of the death of his friend. When the client interacts with these older peers, he attempts to gain acceptance by being submissive, agreeable, and supportive by all means possible. Interaction at school and/or public appearance. The client, for all intents and purposes, makes attempts to conceal his emotions in public when dealing with authority figures. He is respectful, reserved, and makes a conscious effort to remain under the radar of concern. Should concern arise, the client withdraws further within himself to provide an appearance of self-care versus self-harm. This action is brought forth by the client in the form of self-preservation and a means to shield his loved ones. Theoretical orientation. Narrative therapy was selected as the most appropriate method of therapy to serve this client. The approach is being applied to guide the client toward the acceptance and reauthoring of his history of sexual abuse and trauma, in addition to developing skill sets necessary for coping with social anxiety, symptoms of depression, and worthlessness. The client will be empowered to rewrite and recreate his narrative of sexual abuse by the end of a 6-month treatment, as observed by the counselor. Historical context. Narrative therapy was developed by Michael White and David Epstein. David Epstein wrote the first book on the subject. He was also the first to write about externalizing problems. He worked closely with Michael White in developing the foundational framework for narrative therapy.
Narrative therapy is a form of psychotherapy that seeks to help people identify their values and the skills and knowledge they have to live these values, so they can effectively confront whatever problems they face. The therapist seeks to help the person co-author a new narrative about themselves by investigating the history of those qualities. Narrative therapy claims to be a social justice approach to therapeutic conversations, seeking to challenge dominant discourses that it claims shape people's lives in destructive ways. The approach was developed during the 1970s and 1980s, largely by Australian social worker Michael White and David Epstein of New Zealand. While narrative work is typically located within the field of family therapy, many authors and practitioners report using these ideas and practices in community work, schools, and higher education. The narrative therapist focuses upon assisting people to create stories about themselves, about their identities, that are helpful to them. This work of reauthoring identity claims to help people identify their own values and identify the skills and knowledge they have to live these values. Through the process of identifying the history of values in people's lives, the therapist is able to co-author a new story about the person. The story people tell about themselves and that is told about them is important in this approach, which asserts that the story of person's identity determines what they think is possible for themselves. The narrative process allows people to identify what values are important to them and how they might use their own skills and knowledge to live these values.
Narrative therapy is a social constructive approach. We are attempting not to impose things upon the clients. We allow clients to find their own strengths and abilities. We are simply there to guide them through it. The therapist plays the role of a co-editor or co-author, but ultimately it is the client who develops the story and reframes it in a more positive, productive way. What we're trying to do is that we're trying to look at the dominant discourses in this person's life. What are their beliefs about themselves, about life? What is the concepts that they believe in? What is society saying about them, about what's going on? Narrative therapy attempts to help individual members fight these dominant beliefs that are in society, as well as fight these discourses that are in the cultural context or even individually. So the beliefs that they have about themselves. One example can be that of being sexually abused. What is the dominant discourse on sexual abuse, especially that of a female towards a male? Does that have an effect on his mental health when we're talking about how he views the situation? In addition to that, how he views the situation in terms of, is he a victim? Was the situation his fault? Right? What is the dominant discourse and what is he interpreting from it? And we want to help him, guide him, co-author a story that's a little more positive, that he has a little bit more control over. One of these ways is externalizing. In the process of externalization, what we do is that we have clients externalize their feelings. So instead of saying, I am depressed, you would say, I have depression. A person is not their symptomology. A person has symptomology, but isn't their symptomology. We also look at their problem-saturated stories. So problem-saturated stories basically entail stories that are full of problems, right? What are the patterns in the stories, and how can we alter those in a more positive way, make them more solution-oriented? Additionally, we want to deconstruct the story. We want to be able to look at the assumptions and challenge them and make them more positive.
To treat our client, we chose narrative therapy as he uses writing to express his feelings. We'll be guiding the client through three phases, each phase having a short-term goal and a intervention. During the initial stage, sessions 1-3, our short-term goal for our client would be for the client to work and build rapport with the therapist by sharing the narrative of the sexual abuse by his own and thoughts, feelings, and lasting impacts by session 3. The objectives that we have implemented for our client would be for him to be able to verbalize 3-4 negative triggers leading to a symptom such as blackouts and flashbacks to the sexual abuse by the third session. An intervention that we have come up with would be for the client to start sharing an alternative story about a singular event and its corresponding emotion. During the working stage, phase 2, sessions 4-6, our short-term goal for the client would be for them to be able to decrease the statements of shame, being responsible for the abuse, or being the victim. The objectives that the client will have would be for him to be able to state his feelings in a healthier and more appropriate ways by identifying 2-3 positive revisions to his problem-saturated story by the end of the sessions. The interventions that we would be using would be reading between the lines of the problem, repressioning and re-authoring, and externalizing conversations. In phase 3, sessions 7-9, the short-term goal for the client would be for him to be able to take ownership of his story. In order for the client to do this, we would like for him to take and set appropriate boundaries and be able to advocate for himself in social settings, surrounded by peers, family, acquaintances, and so on, and also reducing the level of isolation and increasing his level of social engagement. He would be able to state his narrative as a survivor of sexual abuse. The interventions that we would be using would be mapping, letter writing, and therapeutic documents.
We can choose where we go from there. I know it's not all the answers, but it was enough to start putting these pieces together.
God bless this food we are about to receive. We thank you for this bounty in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 So how do you think the penguins are going to do this year, Dad?
Goddamn penguins. I think they're allergic to goddamn defense.
So what do the players call a puck again?
A biscuit.
Sure, it's not a goddamn biscuit.
You're cooking for a burger.
Honey, I think we're going to have to do a little shopping for you before you take off, huh?
I need some books, though.
Books, too?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. But I think we should get the books first because...
Can Charlie come out and play?
First night we had grilled stickies. So good. You have to visit in the fall. We'll have some, okay?
Definitely.
Oh, sorry. Charlie has a breakdown scheduled for October.
Well, can I tell you something? I've been away for 2 months. It's another world, and it gets better. And my roommate Katie has the best taste in music. I found the tunnel song. Let's drive.
I don't know if I will have the time to write any more letters because I might be too busy trying to participate. So if this does end up being the last letter, I just want you to know that I was in a bad place before I started high school, and you helped me. Even if you didn't know what I was talking about, or know someone who's gone through it, you made me not feel alone. Because I know there are people who say all these things don't happen. And there are people who forget what it's like to be 16 when they turn 17. I know these will all be stories someday, and our pictures will become old photographs. And we'll all become somebody's mom or dad. But right now, these moments are not stories. This has happened. I am here, and I am looking at her. And she is so beautiful. I can see it. This one moment when you know you're not a sad story. You are alive. And you stand up and see the lights on the buildings and everything that makes you wonder. And you're listening to that song on that drive with the people you love most in this world. And in this moment, I swear, we are infinite.
Highlights of the contracting demonstration. Cultural and legal considerations. Cultural considerations. The client is a 15-year-old Caucasian heterosexual male. Cultural considerations will revolve around the dominant discourses, sexual abuse. There is a taboo around the subject in his culture, particularly when it is towards a male. Legal considerations. The client is a minor and requires consent of treatment from parents. Confidentiality and its limits. This includes reporting the past sexual abuse from an adult. Ethical considerations include beneficence and non-maleficence. The therapist should strive to benefit the client and not cause harm. The client is dealing with immense trauma as well as extensive depressive symptomology. This should be considered when working with him. Confidentiality. The therapist should maintain appropriate confidentiality as well as explaining the limits of confidentiality. The therapist is a mandate report. This is especially relevant to the client with a history of sexual abuse. Dominant versus local discourses. Dominant discourses are culturally generated stories about how life should go that are used to coordinate social behavior. Dominant discourses are foundational to how we behave and evaluate our lives. These behaviors or patterns reflect the ideologies of those who have the most power in the society. On the other hand, we also have local discourses, which are the ones that occur in our heads. They have different goods and should than dominant discourses. Narrative therapists pay attention to both local and dominant discourses, and how they collide and create problems and difficulties. Therapeutic relationships. The role of the therapist is one of active listening and questioning, meeting a person apart from the problem, separating people from their problems. In other words, or for example, changing the mindset of I'm depressed to I suffer of depression. Therapist as a co-author and co-editor. Therapist as investigative reporter.
During therapeutic relationships, the therapist plays different roles. They are their own co-author and co-editor when understanding the client's perspective. They are their own investigative reporter in a way that they'll ask questions in order to understand what the problem is and what the client's concern is. And they're able to separate the problem from the person itself. During the therapeutic phases, the counselor gets to know the person and is able to separate the person from the problem. They listen and identify the main problem to create new identities for the life stories to emerge. They are able to reduce the negative effects the problem has on daily living. therefore strengthening their preferred stories. Counselors use different tools and techniques, externalizing conversations in which the counselor is able to separate the person from the problem. Storytelling is when the counselor is asking questions in order to get more detailed responses for them to create their own unique story. Reauthoring is when the client is able to build on exceptions from their story and be able to create a new one in order to be more effective. For letters, the counselor will go ahead and write letters for the client, congratulating them on their hard work and for them to be able to acknowledge their behavior and new alternative narratives. Problem deconstruction would be when the therapist is able to listen to the answers the client gave and be able to determine what tools, what comments, what the client allowed to affect their life, and questions. The therapist will go ahead and ask different questions in order to find the source. We have included some traditional informed questions. For example, how did you become depressed? And relative influence questions, as what made you vulnerable to depression so that it was able to dominate your life. Relative influence questions will be able to invite the client to map out the influence of the problem on their lives and relatives, and also be able to exert on the problem. To finalize our presentation, I would like to say thank you for viewing, and would love to leave you with a quote from The Perks of Being a Wallflower. You see things and you understand. You're a wallflower. Thank you.